Evaporation. This phenomenon is powering many wonders of nature. Evaporation is the force behind the winds, waves, and sometimes devastating hurricanes. Evaporation is all around us. It is what dries our skin on a daily basis. So I wonder why we humans can't control evaporation to do something other than just, say, getting rid of water. But how? How can we control evaporation to run the engines of a car, maybe lift heavy weights, or perhaps generate electricity? We know plants have done it. Trees, they use evaporation to lift water from the soil to the leaves that are hundreds of feet above the ground. The way it works is evaporation creates a suction pressure that pulls water from the soil. If you think about it, some of these trees are taller than the Statue of Liberty and some of the buildings in Manhattan. That's a pretty big deal. So I'm a biophysicist. I develop new kinds of microscopes to look at small things. Microbes, molecules, cells in our bodies. The microscope that I develop looks at small things for their mechanical properties. I had no idea that what I work on could possibly harness evaporation. The microscope I develop is different than the usual ones that you look through some lenses and see a magnified view of things. My microscope works by touching. It has a sharp tip sharpened to the size of atoms and molecules, and this tip is placed at the end of a flexible structure. This structure sways back and forth, touching the surface gently, and twists, and that twist tells how soft and sticky small things are. Small things like microbes, molecules, the building blocks of life. When a microbiologist heard about this microscope, he contacted me and told me that he wants to look at bacterial spores. I was so happy. A scientist was interested in using the microscope that I just invented to look at a puzzling scientific question. But there was one little caveat. What the heck are bacterial spores? I heard about them on TV, and I must have read about them somewhere. So it turns out bacterial spores are everywhere. Bacteria in the soil form spores to protect themselves from harsh environments and from starvation. We may actually inhale them or have eaten them without knowing. Think about that earthy smell after a nice summer rain. Now think again, because what you're smelling might actually be bacterial spores. Raindrops hitting ground, they kick off spores into the air, and that's what causes some of that smell. Now think about some of the probiotic yogurts that you had for breakfast this morning. You actually had bacterial spores in there. They're part of our lives. So they are so tiny that we cannot see them. They are 100 times smaller than a human hair. And they have very interesting shapes. They have wrinkles on their surfaces. Wrinkles just like our skin, just like us. And bacteria from many different species form spores with these wrinkles. And it makes you wonder, do they have an important function? Do they help the spores survive? So some scientists also look at the spores and found out that they change shape. They change in response to humidity. A spore that is in a dry environment sees moisture, takes up water from the air, and expands, gets bigger. And when it sees a dry environment again, it gives the water back, shrinks again, and they can repeat this over and over again. So when I looked at spores with my microscope, I realized that they are very rigid for a biological cell. They're stiffer than most plastics, and that's strange. So when I was working on spores to understand these wrinkles, I kept thinking how amazing they are, how amazing that they can change shape despite being so rigid. But I didn't think about using that for some purpose, for some application. I was just happy to encounter such an interesting phenomenon from a tiny, harmless organism that lives in the soil. But one day I wasn't feeling so good. This was back in 2009, and the US economy wasn't doing so well. And I was among the unfortunate ones in academia who were at their career stages that you have to look for jobs in the midst of an economic crisis. Good luck. So most of the jobs that were out there were related to energy research. They were looking for people working in their area of energy. So how could I possibly apply to one of those jobs? And I thought one night, maybe I should come up with an idea about DNAs and proteins that I looked so much, maybe I can come up with an energy-related application. My thoughts didn't go anywhere, and I fell asleep. The last things on my mind were, maybe I should look at bacterial spores again. They amaze me so much. Maybe when I get back to the office, I should calculate how much energy do they have. So the next morning, I calculated. It was really interesting. My calculations and later experiments showed that spores, a pound of dry spores, have enough energy in them that could lift a car weighing a ton, a meter above the ground. That is a lot of energy. If you think about it, these small organisms have a lot of potential, but because they are so small, how can we get that energy from them? Spores show the way for that too. They can assemble on surfaces densely, shoulder to shoulder, and when they expand, they can push each other out, causing the underlying material to bend and straighten. I tried many different materials to get it right and found out the latex rubber is a good one. What you see now is an invisibly thin layer of spores coated on the surface of latex rubber sheet. And we're blowing air to its surroundings. And as we change the air from humid to dry, the rubber sheet moves. What you see there is actually something like a muscle in our bodies, but an extremely strong one. So what can I do with that? At that point, I thought, maybe I could make use of Legos, the toys that I used to play so much when I was a kid. So I jumped into my car, went to a nearby shopping mall, bought a couple of Lego sets, head back to my lab. And I started thinking, what can I do with this? Maybe I can use this moving material as some sort of an engine and make something working. In the end, I decided I can create a material, I can create a device that can generate electricity from a cup of water. As water evaporates into the room, it will create electricity. And for this to work, I made use of an idea. The idea that moving things can create electricity. That's actually how wind turbines work. They convert motion into electrical energy. So I created a miniature turbine and connected it to the moving rubber sheet with Legos. And when you put this little device next to a cup of water, with the help of flowing air, it produces electricity. The air picks up moisture from the surface of water, carries it into the spores, makes them move, and the magnet, the turbine generator, creates electricity. And if you allow the spores to dry again, you can just repeat this. If you think about it, standing body of water, a cup of water, is something so familiar to us, to our surroundings. Lakes, seas, and oceans, they all evaporate into the dry air. They have the potential to generate electricity. Our devices are getting more and more efficient and robust. We are working on this constantly, and what you see now is a device that responds to me breathing. In this video, I'm standing next to this device. I'm inhaling and exhaling frequently. And the spores in this material, they pull and push a mechanical arm working like an engine, creating a piston-like motion. You can now think about using this for many different applications. So what I showed you so far may be baby steps towards harnessing one of the most powerful forces in nature. I think evaporation has a great potential. It can provide a much-needed renewable energy source. If done right, evaporation can preserve fresh water and generate power at the same time. Both are very important for our society. It can also deliver energy right when it is needed because it can store energy in the environment for later use. I think the power in evaporation is worth pursuing. Thank you.